trying to stop dancing, and you'll fall on your face in front of all these people.
Amir Bobblepet, a charity case. Somebody that Wolf and I got to know after we discovered some tapestries that belonged to her boss, Kurt Botwild.
The interior designer? The gold leaf man?
Yes, the same one.
May I cut in?
Of course. The charity's safe.
Archie's such a good partner. Are you his Monday night partner? I'm only allowed Wednesdays.
Ah, yes. Monday nights. Regular as pot roast in a diner. Of course, you know what the rules are. You take him over now, you have to see him home.
My pleasure.
Strike two. You're out.
I thought you were allowed three strikes.
Not in my game.
I guess I'm yours.
Hopefully forever, my darling.
Have
you considered my proposal?
Yes.
Friday, I need you to drive Andy and me out to Long Island to Mr. Hewitt's house. He's having Mr. Thompson over for the afternoon.
I told you yesterday that I have a date for Friday afternoon.
Mr. Thompson is the best hybridizer in England. We'll be leaving at 12:30, Archie.
His taking it for granted like that was too much. I didn't try to sound sorry.
I really am very sorry, but I cannot break my date for Friday. See, Margot Dickey asked me to a party. Christmas party. We never have a Christmas party around here.
Christmas, as celebrated, is merely an excuse for wretched excess, aptly symbolized by an elephantine elf who delivers gifts to the whole world in one night.
Here's a thought. Andy can drive. Your idea that a car is a death trap unless I'm the one driving it is unsound.
If my feeling that you alone are to be trusted at the wheel of a car is an aberration, I have it. We'll be leaving at 12:30 for Hewitt's.
So there we were. He needed a lesson, and I had in my possession a document that would make it good.
I didn't intend to spring this on you until tomorrow, but today will have to do.
Marriage license. But for Archie Goodwin and Margot Dickey. Philly, what kind of flummery is that?
Oh, it's not flummery at all. Nope. All I can say is I'm finally hooked, and it took an expert to hook me. Yes, sir. Miss Dickey intends to spread the tidings at the party. And when you're going to announce you caught a fish, well, it helps to have the fish present.
The effect was all I could have asked.
You're deranged.
Yes, yes, quite possibly. It might be a form of madness. As Margot was reading to me the other night, it was some poet, some Greek. It was, oh, love!
Just shut up and sit down. Sit down.
Yes, sir. You know, I was inspired by your offer to Andy and his late lamented fiancée, but now that it's permanent, well, you may decide that you don't want me here anymore, and I'd like to stay. I like the pay, especially if I get a raise by the first of the year. I like working for the greatest living private detective in the free world.
Sit down.
I appreciate it. Fritz's cooking. I like the billiard table in the basement. I even like the color yellow. That's a lot to ask. I told Margot all about it, see? Yeah, I told her you were allergic to women, and we decided, well, we didn't decide yet, but we thought that we might want to give it a try, see? After the honeymoon, you know. Go on the honeymoon, and then we'll decide.
I don't believe you.
Why not?
What of Miss Rowan?
Oh, well, she met Miss Dickey last night, and she'll probably never speak to me again.
What are the thousands of others you dally with?
Oh, not thousands, not even a thousands. Dally, I want to look up Dally.
Just sit down!
Yes, okay, yes, sir. No, sir, I won't sit down. Look, I know we're going to have to discuss this and everything, but right now you're a little unsettled, so it might take a day or two. I think that'll be better for you to come around, you know, get used to the idea. I hope you do come around, too.
For Botwell Studio, good morning.
Yes, hello, Cherry. This is Archie Goodwin speaking. Could I please speak to Margot?
Archie?
Yes, I've got it. It's mine.
I knew you could. Where are you?
I'm at Wolf's office. I just broke the news. What are you doing? Sorry about that. Say, what about meeting me at the Tulip Bar at the Churchill Hotel? I'd like to buy you a drink.
I'd like to buy you a drink.
Oh, love.
We'll miss this place.
For the rest of that night and all the next morning, the atmosphere around Wolf's was not very seasonal. Neither of us mentioned the state of bliss I was headed for or the adjustments that would have to be made.
Where did you get that hat?
Thank you, Fritz.
Take it off! Not in my house!
And so it was on that Friday, Wolf went out for the second time in 1 week. Fritz and I heard the front doorbell ring, and as we turned the hallway corner, what to our wondering eyes should appear but Nero Wolf in full winter gear. It was a day for breaking all precedents. He even answered the door himself.
It's 12:30 precisely. How did you arrange it?
I don't know.
I admit I was relieved. He had needed a lesson. But if he had passed up a chance for an orchid powwow with the best hybridizer in England, I would never have heard the last of it. As it was, I would never hear the last of it from Lily. I headed for my room to change. At 4 o'clock, I was in Botwell's elevator, rising to the occasion. Botwell's studio would have made a fine den for a blind billionaire. The only difference I could see between chrome modern and Botwell's gold leaf modern was the color.
Archie, come help us sample.
Three brands, no monotony for Kurt.
You got a Santa Claus to tend the bar. How very modern. Aren't you supposed to be making lists? Thank you, Miss Dickie. Well, to drink champagne with a blonde at one elbow and a brunette at the other gives a man a great sense of well-being. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. Jerry. Might be a client, handy girl.
Don't call me that.
Kurt does.
Yes, Kurt does.
Handy girl. Yes, I remember Botwell has given all of you a funny name. What does he call you?
Contact woman.
Yes, very appropriate.
I thought this was a family gathering. Nobody told me others were invited.
I invited him.
Well, if you hadn't, I would have. I didn't like you much when you was haunting tapestries, but you seem all right tonight, though.
You're Irish. This is a Christmas party. You like everybody.
That's right!
Cannon's name was Paperboy. He made sure the client signed on the dotted line.
Do you mind if I...
Botwell called Emile Hatch the pet wizard, and he looked the party at a sour face, a sour voice, and a sour taste.
Ah, Archie Goodwin, may I present Leo Jerome?
Oh, yes, I'm acquainted with your mother, Mrs. Perry Porter, Jerome.
Pleasure.
Leo's manners were just like Mom's.
Look at all the pretty colors.
And as pretty as you, of course. Yes, if only that license were real.
You know, I can get one for $2. What do you say?
You wouldn't marry Miss Universe if she came on her knees with $1 billion.
Did it work?
Perfect. Simply perfect.
So you're ditching me for about a while.
Yes, Archie, darling, but I'll always be a sister to you.
I don't need a sister. I need that license back before they hook me for forgery.
He tore it up.
Where'd he put the pieces?
I don't know, in the wastebasket. Will you come to the wedding?
I will not. My heart is bleeding.
Well, there he is. Kurt!
Merry, merry, merry. Let the darkest corner be touched with light. Goodwin, you hear? Good. Edith, your pet sleuth.
I still hadn't labeled Botwell. He could talk baseball stats with me and archaeology with Wolf. He wasn't much to look at, but he had something.
There are times when love takes over.
Here it comes, once my own.
No, not yet.
You don't like this stuff.
Oh, I can stand a sip, Al.
Oh, but you won't enjoy it. Wait, wait. Sandy, get another glass.
Goodwin. I must tell Wolf I'd like to dine with him again soon. We haven't finished on the Dead Sea Scrolls.
Here we go. Now it's unanimous.
My secret public vice. I repeat. There are times when love takes over. There are times when all the little demons disappear down their rat holes. And the trumpet call of good cheer and goodwill drowns out the babble of mean little noises. This is such a time. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas.
Mary, Mary, Mary.
That was lovely. I must have it written down and printed. That bit about the trumpet call. Kurt? What is it? Kurt!
Mary.
All right, get back, get back. Everyone get back. Call a doctor. Call a doctor.
There was nothing to do and I knew it. I got a whiff of his breath and I know that smell. It takes a big dose of cyanide to hit that quick and hard.
Even if a doctor came within 3 minutes and washed out his stomach with chemicals he probably didn't have, I don't think it would do much good. It might be 1 in 1,000, but as it is...
Could you do something?
Not for him. His heart has stopped. Now, until the police come...
The police?
No one is to touch anything, especially that bottle of Pernod. Everyone must stay right here. Where did Santa go? Anyone see where Santa went?
He couldn't have taken the elevator. We would have heard it.
All right, everyone stay right here. Kiernan, you call the police. Employee 53100.
Right.
Santa had molted. I didn't check to see if it was all there because I had another errand and not much time for it. It was now 20 minutes to 7. Some 24 city employees had furnished the on-the-scene routine. Inspector Kramer had departed to organize the hunt for Santa Claus. Sergeant Pearlie Stebbins stayed behind to make sure everything was understood.
Do you mean that no one knows anything at all about the man who acted as Santa Claus?
But while himself arranged for him. He ordered the costume from Burleson's. Miss Kwan here admits to receiving the package and taking it into Buttweil in his office. We're also covering any agencies that might have supplied a man to act Santa Claus.
If he was just hired to do a job, he'd be a damn fool to sneak out.
Maybe he was too scared to think. Maybe he had a record. But if that was it, if he was just a guy that Buttweil hired, he wouldn't have had any reason to kill him.
The killer knew about the Pernod. You're wasting your time with agencies.
We waste most of our time, Mr. Hatch. I just want you to understand that if that's where Buttweil got him, it's going to be hard to believe that Santa Claus put the poison in that bottle.
Does that mean that that I and my son are under suspicion?
I'm saying first we find Santa Claus, then we'll see. Of course, there is the fact that the medical examiner said that the poison was cyanide. Hey, there's a large jar of that in the workshop.
I use it all the time to gild things.
Anyone who knew that, and who knew that Buttweil kept an open bottle of Pernod in his desk, couldn't have asked for a better setup. Four of you admit to knowing both of those things. Mrs. Jerome, Mr. Jerome, Mr. Archie Goodwin here admit to knowing about the Pernod, but not the cyanide. That'll be enough.
That's
for
not true. She knew about it. How dare you, you slut!
Hey, hey, hey.
Sit down. Now, come on. Take it easy.
Jeez.
Miss Kwan?
In the workshop one day, I heard Mr. Hatch telling her how careful he had to be with it.
Mr. Hatch? Do you verify what she just said?
Nonsense! What if he did? I won't tolerate this abuse!
Now you listen to me, Mrs. Jerome. As far as I know right now, only one of you has lied to me. You. Now I'm telling you. I'm telling all of you. Lies are only going to make it harder for you. But sometimes, they make it easier for us.
Now that put me in a class with Mrs. Jerome, since I had left out my little talk with Margot.
And I want to know about their families. Anything you can dig up. Put the whole squad on it if you want to. But get that information to me as well.
The party was now officially over.
Want to talk to you, Goodwin.
Listen, if I'm invited downtown, I'm willing, but I'm going to go get something to eat first, okay? Because last time I was there, I nearly starved.
What were you doing here today?
Oh, I was having a very nice time, as you can see. Miss Dickey invited me.
Why? You're nothing to her. She was going to marry Buttweil.
Well, then it must be the three different kinds of champagne.
I ask her again.
And I tell you again. She asked me. Why don't you ask her?
I did. She says no particular reason, but she stuttered around about it. Any comment?
Good girl. I'd rather have to eat all the snow that had fallen since noon than explain the wedding license to Stebbins and Kramer. That was why I'd gone through the wastebasket.
I know you, Goodwin. I know you.
Yeah, I know. You even called me Archie, and it's a memory I will treasure forever.
You're telling me you let Stanley walk out of here and didn't see him?
Nuts. I was kneeling on the ground watching a man die.
Then you're slipping. You know what everybody mentions? Sandy wore gloves. What for if not to leave no prints? You know who he is, don't you?
No.
I ain't saying he's the murderer. But if you know who he is and you don't want him involved and we break our ankles looking for him, what about that?
Oh, that'd be bad. That'd be real bad. If I asked my advice, I'd be against it.
God damn it. You're gonna want to see me downtown tomorrow morning.
Yeah, just don't make it too early. I'll be kind of tuckered out, have a little breakfast first, and I'll come there, I'll let you know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
By the time I got home, Wolf was already in his oversized chair at the end of the table. He told me good evening, not snapping or barking. I returned it and apologized for being late.
Fritz! What do we have?
Something you would like. Duck à l'orange.
You know, I approve of your rule never to discuss business during dinner, but...
The death of Mr. Botwell was reported on the radio at 7 o'clock. You were there.
Yes, I was. I'm sure as soon as they find Santa Claus, that may settle it. What I want to report is what happened before Botwell died. That marriage license I showed you?
Oh, yes.
It's for the birds. Miss Dickie called it off, and I'm out $2.
Indeed.
No. She said she wanted to marry Botwell. Then 10 minutes later, he died. Where does that leave me?
Well, for me, of course, this is satisfactory. There's a book that I want to look at. It's up in your room. Here and Now by Herbert Block. Can you bring it down for me, please?
That meant climbing 2 flights on a full stomach, but I was glad to oblige. I wanted to show how I appreciated how calmly he accepted the announcement of my shattered hopes. Traffic jam inside my skull with horns blowing, brakes squealing, a head-on collision. Why had he taken this method of telling me he was Santa Claus? Why didn't he just tell me? Why? Because he'd been desperate. Now, the idea of a woman living in his house, or the alternative, my leaving that house, had made him absolutely desperate. So he came to see me and Margot together. He came to see for himself. The point was this. He had shown that rather than lose me, he would do something that he wouldn't have done for any fee anybody could name. And he'd sent me to my room so I would realize I was not to mention that aspect of things.
You're all right to wear the gloves. I would have recognized your hands. Where'd you get them?
Confound it. I didn't know a man was going to be murdered.
I know you didn't. May I ask you some questions? I'll take that as a yes. When did you arrange it?
2:30 yesterday afternoon.
Do you have any reason to believe that
Botwell tell anyone about it?
He said he would.
When you left at 12:30, did you go straight to Botwell's?
No. No, I left at that hour. Because you and Fritz expected me to. Well, I stopped to buy the gloves. And then I had lunch at Rusterman's with Botwell. And we arrived at his studio at 2:00. Took his private elevator up to his office.
Well, there's the package. And there's the dressing room. I always have a Pernod after lunch. It's my secret public vice. You care to join me?
He then poured a liberal portion into a glass and then drank it in 2 gulps, returned the bottle to his desk drawer.
Cops would love to know about that.
No doubt. I then took the uniform and went to a private dressing room at the rear of his office while he went to see a client in his studio. He had ordered the largest size, but it was a squeeze, so it took a while, a half hour, more.
You're mistaken.
Botwell helped me with the beard and the wig.
So no one saw you unmasked?
No.
Why didn't you leave the gloves in the elevator with the costume?
The gloves did not come with it.
Gloves weren't included?
No. No, the gloves were separate. I don't know why. Anyway, Fritz didn't expect me home till 6:00 or later, so I walked to the public library and spent some 2 hours there and took a cab home.
Over a mile, his longest and hardest tramp since Montenegro, fighting his way through a blizzard in terror of the law on his tail.
Oh, marry and be damned.
That was dangerous. That could get us onto the aspect that he sent me to my room to think over alone.
Pardon me. Something caught in my throat. Now, would you like to describe the situation, or should I?
I would like to hear you try.
Okay. You're sunk. Now, if you were to call Kramer now, and I mean now, and invite him over for some beer, and tell him, well, it'd be a nuisance, but it would be bearable.
No.
Tell him you bet me $100 that you could be in a room for 10 minutes and I wouldn't recognize you.
No!
But you know, they're gonna trace the sale of the gloves to the buyer, and then they'll get a description. Now, if you sit tight and you wait, you won't dare tell him that you saw Botwell take a drink from that bottle shortly after 2:00, and he was fine. Didn't hurt him. Because if you wait and until he comes and he finds you to tell him all that, well, then he'll get you for withholding evidence, and he'll make it stick. Now, I can get Kramer right now. I'm sure he's in his office.
No, I will not confess that performance to Mr. Kramer, no. I will not unfold the morning paper to a disclosure of this outlandish masquerade, no.
So you're gonna sit and read that book here now until they come with a warrant?
That would be fatuous. No, I will find the murderer and present him to Mr. Kramer. There's nothing else.
Oh. Oh, you're gonna find the murderer?
Yes.
Oh, I see. You're gonna find the murderer. Yeah. Well, why didn't you tell me? Instead of letting me spout on and on and on.
Well, I just wanted to see what your appraisal of the situation was and if it agreed with mine. It does. Good.
Great. Well, then you also may know that we have perhaps 2 weeks or 2 minutes.
Yes, I do. Well, in your intimate association with Miss Dickey, you must have found out things about all these people. What? What did you find out?
Let me explain something to you. My association with Miss Dickey is not intimate.
Archie, choose your adjective. I meant no innuendo.
Oh, no, no, no. It's not a matter of adjectives. You see, Miss Dickey is a good dancer, an exceptionally good dancer. And I would go dancing with her Wednesday nights at the Flamingo.
Yes, the same establishment that you dance with Miss Rowan. Does she not object?
She didn't know anything about it. That is until Miss Dickey came up and introduced herself to Miss Rowan on Monday night and created some rather unfortunate consequences. But anyway,
yes.
Margot Dickey asked me for a favor. See, she was planning to marry Botwile for about a year, and then she thought Cherry Kwan was making a play for Botwile. She didn't want Cherry to take the rails, so she asked me a favor. She asked me if I could get her a marriage license and put my name on it, her name on it, and then present it to Botwile and say it's now and ever. Well, I thought I was doing a good deed. And as I said, she's a good dancer. She's a very good dancer.
Huh. So you are not on intimate terms with Miss Dickey?
No, sir.
Even so, she must have spoken of the establishment and of those people. One of them killed Botwile.
Well, okay. Mrs. Jerome. Now, Mrs. Jerome put about $500,000 into the enterprise. She thinks she owns Botwile. She was his angel.
Right. Was she jealous of Margot?
Margot and Cherry. As for Leo, the kid, if he thought that his mother was dishing out his inheritance, well, then he might have reason. As for Mr. Kiernan, well, the way he was looking at Cherry Kwan this afternoon, if he thought Botwile was first in line for...
He might be tempted to.
That's right.
What about Mr. Hatch?
Mr. Hatch, well, I wouldn't be surprised if Mr. Hatch wiped out the whole bunch of them on general principles. He practically told me this afternoon that he created the entire enterprise and never got any credit for it. As for Cherry Kwan, now, if I was going to be poisoned by anyone, I'd want it to be Cherry.
That's only 5.
I got Margot a license to marry, not a license to kill. If she was lying when she told me it worked, then she's almost as good a liar as she is a dancer. If they had hit on Santa Claus's trail and led to Nero Wolf, Kramer was much more apt to come than to call.
Wow. Hello, Mr. Goodwin. I'm here to see Nero Wolf.
Is that so? Well, please. As I have said, Cherry was highly decorative, and I want to point out she went fine with the red leather chair.
I saw you this afternoon, but it wasn't the same thing. You could have been anybody dressed in that silly Santa Claus costume.
I'm at a loss, Miss Kwan. You say you saw me today in a Santa Claus costume.
Oh, I'm sorry. You haven't told them. Then it's a good thing I haven't told them either.
My dear madam, if you must talk in riddles, talk to Mr. Goodwin. He enjoys them.
I thought you were clever. If I tell the police, even if they don't like to believe me, they will have to investigate. Of course.
She weighed about 102. I could carry her under one arm with my other hand clamped on her mouth and lock her into the cubbyhole in the basement. Or, as an alternative, I could get a gun from my desk drawer and shoot her.
I think we understand each other.
I only understand that you want something, madam. What?
I know who killed him. You see, Margot and Kurt were having an affair. A few months ago, Kurt began on me, and it was hard because I had a strong feeling for him. I told him the first man I slept with would be my husband.
Madam.
But then last night he phoned me. He said he had broken with Margot for good and wanted to marry me. That's when he told me about you. You're arranging to be Santa Claus.
I have not yet conceded that. But have we arrived at the point? Did Miss Dickey kill Mr. Botwell?
Of course she did.
And you told the police that?
Yes, but they won't listen.
You have no evidence, then?
She was so clever, being so nice at the party. They could never prove it.
You are vulnerable to an action for slander. You understand that.
But what I was thinking, Mr. Wolf, is that you are vulnerable, too.
And you want me to provide the evidence?
That's what I want. Did I say it so you understand it?
Oh, yes. Indeed. You put it admirably.
His tone was dry, but not hostile. But I could see a muscle twitching beneath his right ear, and she couldn't.
I suppose, Miss Kwan, that it would be futile to advance the possibility that one of the others killed him.
I know she killed him.
I don't. You will hear from me tomorrow.
I can't wait longer than tomorrow morning to go to the police.
Phew, you can and will. The moment you disclose that, you no longer have a whip to dangle at me. You'll hear from me tomorrow.
I hope it will be early tomorrow.
At 4:30 the following afternoon, Wolf was in the plant room. There was no note on my desk, so I had no instructions. But my desk ashtray contained three stubs from Pharaoh's cigarettes. Saul Panzer smokes Pharaoh's. I buzzed the plant room.
Yes, is it all right to empty my ashtray?
Yes, please do so.
Then what do I do?
I'll tell you at 6 o'clock.
Possibly earlier.
I checked the lockbox in the safe. Saul had not been supplied with funds.
Nero Wolfs. Saul.
Glad to know you're back home safe. Tell Mr. Wolf that everything's all set, no snags.
Anything else?
Yes.
Yes. Saul phoned to say everything's all right. No snags. Congratulations. Now listen, if I'm in the way, I can call Miss Rowan and go dancing.
Well, oddly enough, you're not. Have chairs in place for the visitors. 10 should be enough.
4 or 5 will be there shortly after 6 o'clock. I hope not more.
Others will come later.
Anything else for me?
Yes. Stop calling.
The first set arrived between 6:15 and 6:20.
Please be seated. No, not there. Right there.
Mrs. Jerome copped the red leather chair, but I moved her, mink and all, to one of the yellow ones.
Miss Kwan?
Cherry might be headed for a very different kind of chair, wired for power. But even so, I thought she rated that background, and Mrs. Jerome didn't.
This morning, I sent each of you an identical invitation, saying that Mr. Goodwin has certain information which he feels he must give the police not later than tonight. Now, I have persuaded Mr. Goodwin to let me discuss it with you first. The difficulty is that any of you, including Miss Dickey and Mr. Kiernan, had the opportunity to poison that bottle. Did you not?
Nuts! It was that guy playing Santa Claus. I was with Botwell and my mother the entire time.
Botwell is dead, and your mother is your mother. And she was being milked by Botwell of your future fortune, sir. Now, when did you learn, Mrs. Jerome, that Kurt intended to marry Cherry Kwan?
Kurt marry her? That strumpet?
I thought he was going to marry Margot.
Margot?
Everybody knew that but you. But if Kurt had changed his mind, Mrs. Jerome would have gone for Cherry, not Kurt. Al Kiernan, on the other hand, he would have murdered 100 Kurts to get to Cherry.
Yeah, perhaps, yes. Now, Archie.
It looked as if the time had come to pass on the information which I felt I must give the police without delay, which was difficult because I didn't have any. Luckily, the doorbell rang.
We got a couple of your friends here, Goodwin.
What's all this?
Miss Kwan, if you don't mind moving, Mr. Kramer likes that chair.
You're under arrest, Panzer. And you'll stay with Stebbins. And you keep your mouth shut. I'm running this.
You are not running this, Mr. Kramer. Not in my house. No, you should know better than that. If Mr. Panzer is under arrest, take him. Otherwise, sit down while I tell you who killed Kurt Bottweil. Come on, it's your chair. It's your chair. Now, I assume that you know for the past 2 months that Mr. Goodwin has been seeing something of Miss Dickey. He says she dances well.
Oh, save that for later. I want to know if you sent Panzer to that
bus. For that. Archie, if you please, tell us what Miss Dickey asked you to do late last Tuesday evening.
Well, Bottweil promised to marry her next week. He'd made this promise, well over a year ago. And she wanted a showdown. So I was supposed to get a marriage license, put her name on it, my name on it, and she would show it to Bottweil and say it's now or never, pal.
Yes, and yesterday afternoon?
She told me the license trick worked perfectly.
Did she tell you what had happened to the license?
Well, yes, he saw the license, Bottweil, that is, and he tore it up and threw it in the waste paper basket. That was the night before Thursday.
And what did you do when you went to the office after Bottweil had died?
Well, I dumped the waste basket, and then I picked the pieces up and put them in one by one, and there was no sign of a marriage license.
And you made sure of that?
Oh, yes.
And Cherry took them.
What? You took them, you little slut.
Miss Dickey, please.
I will not wait any longer, Mr. Wolf. You said that.
Miss Kwan, I am doing this. Now, another fact. Yesterday, I had lunch with Kurt Bottweil. He called before to say he needed some white cotton gloves, and would I stop and get them? It struck me as peculiar. But then again, he was a rather peculiar man.
Kramer wasn't buying any part of it, which was unjustified since some of it was true.
Vaguely that he'd taken pity on a vagabond and had hired him to serve drinks costumed as Santa Claus. However, the only way to make his hands presentable and acceptable to the public would be to have him wear gloves.
You would have reported that.
I decided that rather than suffer your rebuke for not reporting it earlier, I would solve the case. I needed first to talk with one of Bottweil's employees, and I did, with Miss Kwan last evening.
He looked at Cherry, of course, for any signs of danger. She had started to blurt it out once and might again, but she didn't move a muscle.
This morning I had Mr. Saul Panzer do two errands. The first was the delivery of some messages, the text of which ran as follows. When I was there Thursday putting on my costume, I saw what you did. Be at the newspaper stand at the corner of 10th Avenue and 45th Street at 6:30 p.m. today. I'll come up to you and say, Saint Nick, and the messages were signed Santa Claus.
Oh, God, you admit it.
I proclaim it. Yeah, if the murderer believed he had been observed, he would be irresistibly impelled to meet the writer of the message, don't you think? Now, have you any questions? Anyone? About anything? So, you may report now. You were in the vicinity of the newspaper stand shortly before 6:30.
Yes, sir, at 6:20. Within 3 minutes, I had recognized three homicide men that were scattered around different spots. I don't know if any of them recognized me. And then at 6:28, I saw Alfred Kiernan standing around. Then I saw Margot Dickey come out of the alley, and I followed your instructions. St. Nick?
Who are you and what do you want?
Choose me a moment, madam. I'll be right with you. St. Nick!
Anything else, sir?
No, that's satisfactory. I assume Mr. Kiernan gave your men a signal.
Yes. He brought us the message along with Mrs. Jerome, her son, and Hatch. And we set up a surveillance.
But not Miss Dickey?
No. Neither did Miss Kwan.
Well, let us ask. Why did Miss Dickey tell Mr. Goodwin that Botwell was going to marry her if it wasn't true? I mean, surely a stupid thing to do, since he would inevitably learn the truth. But it wasn't so stupid if she had already put the poison in the bottle. It would purge her of motive, or at least help. Any comment, Miss Dickey?
Cherry did it. She killed him.
Don't answer him. I'm running this now.
It was her. She's jealous. She's jealous because he wants to marry me. He loved me.
Yeah, but she didn't go meet the blackmailer. And you did.
Archie, please.
Burley?
That seemed unnecessary. I was sitting right across from her and might have been trusted to grab her, but Pearlie's never very considerate of other people's feelings, especially mine.
Please, Archie, help me!
What was Saul's second errand?
Saul interviewed the cleaning woman at Botwell's. The wastebasket in his office had been emptied Thursday afternoon.
Before Margot had her conference with Kurt.
Yeah, since there was no reason for anyone to remove only those pieces, presumably Miss Dickey lied. And if she lied about the license, the rest of what she said was under suspicion. Where are you going?
Out!
To attend to your thousands, I suppose.
I looked up the word, Dally. It means to act playfully, especially amorously, to linger, to waste time. I intend to dally.
Lock the door as you leave.
Monday.
That charity case you were so jealous of, well, she's on her way to jail.
I'm not jealous.
She murdered the man she loved.
She had the right idea.
I thought we would stay home tonight and do a little dancing.